Good morning and thank you for the invitation, and it is a pleasure to be here again and to meet you. And I will speak about how to read breast MRI, and there might be or there is going to be some overlap with the first lecture of Dr. Tali Arazi, so I will skip those issues that were already dealt. So I will speak about the technical aspects, and I think those are very, very important to begin with. And we are, as audiologists, are responsible for the technical and for the optimal technique, since we rely on the final images that we get from the technologies, and we have to read those images, and they have to be almost perfect for an accurate assessment and evaluation. And I will talk about the breast MRI, how do we read it, and the unique features describing the fibroglandular density, the background parenchymal enhancement, and the mass or the findings evaluation, including the mass, non-mass, and foci. And unique for MRI is the evaluation of morphology and the kinetic assessment. We review our studies according to the BioMed lexicon, and then we review a few cases. So, as we have heard, breast MRI is the most sensitive examination to detect breast cancer, and the sensitivity is almost 100 or 97%, and it depends on imaging of angiogenesis, and it relies on demonstration of the vessels, and the vessels are abnormal in the area of breast cancer, and there is a leak from the vessels and shunting, and this is responsible for the enhancement, the rapid enhancement, and the rapid washout that is seen in breast cancer. And when we evaluate breast MRI, we are looking at the morphology and at the kinetic patterns. So when we start to read breast MRI, it is very important to have a systematic and an organized approach to read the study, and to have a protocol to review the images, which is going to be consistent. It is very important at the beginning to review the entire study, all the images. And breast MRI, there are approximately between 2,000 and above images which should be reviewed. And the final report should include the clinical history. We should be aware of the clinical history. We should be aware of the MRI technique. We should be aware of previous studies. It is not a standalone examination, although it is our best examination. We should describe the findings and a final BI-RADS assessment and recommendation. So before the examination, just again to review, we should be familiar with the indications, and as was previously discussed, preoperative staging is one of the most important. We know that women that had breast MRI, additional findings of breast cancer were found in up to 30% of the patient. And we can detect either multifocal or multicentric or contralateral disease. It is the same for invasive and DCIS. I have been asked whether it is also women with DCIS. Do we or should we recommend breast MRI? So yes, DCIS MRI is very sensitive also for DCIS. So pre-op MRI in a setup of DCIS is also indicated. Of course, evaluation of recurrence, either evaluation of residual disease in a patient that has positive margins, lumpectomy, or to differentiated scar from recurrence, evaluation of treatment response in women with neoadjuvant chemotherapy and locally advanced breast cancer, mammographically occult lesions, implants, and screening. MRI is the most sensitive in women with in women that are high risk, such as BRCA. So let's look before starting the examination, the clinical history. The clinical history is very, very important. What is the reason for the examination? And if, for example, the reason is a palpable lesion, the technician should place a skin marker, a vitamin E, to indicate what is the problem and to mark it on the questionnaire that the woman fills. It is very important to know whether the patient had previous procedures such as biopsy, such as surgery, such as radiation, such as clip mark placement. Those are very important for the accurate correlation of the findings that we are going to detect. Again, scheduling is very, very important for premenopausal women. According to the menstrual cycle, the best time is day 7 to 14. However, this is only in the screening setup. If a premenopausal woman has already diagnosed breast cancer, we are not going to wait for the next menstrual cycle. We are going to perform the study as urgent as we can do in order to evaluate the extent of disease. The importance of the scheduling is the influence on the background parenchymal enhancement, and we'll see it soon. And about the hormonal therapy, again, as was mentioned before, it is important that the secretary that performs the scheduling will ask the patient or will ask the woman, do you receive hormone replacement therapy? And if yes, we recommend to stop it. We always have argument with our gynecologist, but basically the recommendation is to stop 6 weeks, but it is sometimes difficult for the woman, so it's between three. We do a compromise, it's between 3 and 6 weeks, but it is important to know about it, to stop the hormone replacement therapy. And just to show you the effect, this is, for example, a 55-year-old woman. She's postmenopausal, she's high risk, and she that's why that was the reason for the MRI. And you can see this irregular enhancing lesion, very suspicious. However, since she said that she is receiving hormonal replacement therapy, that she didn't stop, we recommended before doing a biopsy to stop the hormone replacement therapy for 4 weeks and repeated the scan, and the scan was completely normal. So it is very, very important to know about the treatment and to recommend stopping it. So before the study, the woman feels a questionnaire about the clinical history recommendation, and I think that every MRI unit has its own that basically reviews the same information, and it is also important to fill the MR safety questionnaire. And as was already described, we are always doing today bilateral breast MRI. It is always with contrast. There is no point in doing non-contrast. However, after hearing the diffusion lecture, it is possible to do, or I think that today there are there is research to evaluate whether we can perform a diffusion-weighted MRI without contrast as a standalone. In our unit, we are trying to evaluate the DTI, the diffusion tensor imaging, which is also possible to perform without contrast. However, if we are doing dynamic contrast MRI, the traditional MRI, it is always with gadolinium. It was also pointed that it is important to have dedicated technologies that will be familiar with the proper positioning of the woman in the MRI machine. And it is important to properly center the breast in the middle of the coil and not to have this kind of rotation. And I will show you the influence of the improper technique. And when we read the MRI, it is important to identify the sequences that we are reviewing. So the first one is the localizer, that we have to review that the patient was positioned properly. The second scan is the dynamic multiphase T1 gradient echo, and it starts with the first scan that is non-contrast, followed by contrast injection and repetition 3, 4, or 5 times, and it is followed by a T2 non-fat set, non-fat suppression scan. Those are basically the basic scans. The next acquisitions or images that we have are non-acquisition. Those are performed at the workstation or by the computer, and including the subtraction, the reconstruction, the CAD, and they are not part of the scanning protocol of the woman. So this is, for example, the scout, axial scout, and we can see an improper positioning with the compression of the coil here. It might, following the contrast injection, it might cause to not optimal enhancement in this area and confuse or close to a false positive or false negative findings. And now let's review the sequence of the images that we have. So the first one is the T1 non-contrast. We perform it with fat suppression. However, it is important to have a non-fat suppressed scan, so this one can be done either with non-fat suppression. It is followed by contrast injection and the multiphase T1 scan. It is very important to identify that there is contrast in the large vessels or in the heart. It is very important also, this is also a T1 post-contrast to evaluate the axilla. The lymph nodes are very well seen. The next image or the next series is the T2 non-fat suppression axial scan. And we perform also the sagittal T2 with fat saturation, but this is an optimal scan. So those are the acquisitions. This is the actual time that the woman spends at the MRI machine. It is very important since, as was mentioned, the MRI examination is not convenient, nice. Some of the women, it's very difficult for them to lie in the bed. So the actual scan time, this is approximately 7 minutes. This is another 2, 3, 4. And this is another 2, 3, 4. So basically, we can conclude our study or our examination at 20 minutes with a good quality of the examination. The rest of the scans or the images are post-processing. I would like to just to stress the importance of the non-fat saturation images, either T2 or T1, to identify either fat in fat necrosis or fat in lymph nodes. Again, the next images or a series are the post-processing, and the most important one is the subtraction, as was mentioned before. This is the most important scan. And again, evaluate the presence of contrast. Very, very important that you evaluate, and the technologies, the techniques, the technologies that are doing the examination, evaluate that you have the contrast. Sometimes the woman will not complain that there was that she didn't receive or that there is a PAR. Very, very important, and evaluate artifacts. In addition, part of the post-processing, I think it is very important to have multiplanar reformats, coronal, sagittal, MIP, okay, and the CAD. Very, very important. This is one of the advantages of the MRI, that we can have, we finish the acquisition and we can have the multiplanar reformats. The T2 FET set, as we heard, is important, or it can assist us to identify cysts or T2 high signal lesions such as lymph nodes and fibroadenomas. And just, I would like to review a few of the artifacts. This is, for example, a T1 post-contrast, and we can see in the middle part of both breast high signal, and this is due to the compression of the breast over the coil. We can reduce it or we can avoid it by padding and raising the breast from the coil at the sternal area, and to reduce this artifact. The same high signal T1 sagittal images with high signal areas due to the breast touching the coil. This is another example of the breast touching the coil, and the breast was padded at this area and the artifact disappeared. More artifacts when the breast touches the coil and there is high signal which might confuse with enhancement. The same for T2 non-fat set, and the woman was repositioned properly. This is an example of a pseudo lesion that is due to improper positioning. In the left breast we can see a lesion. The woman was repositioned, and we can see that the nipple now is in profile and there is no lesion. Very, very important that we evaluate that the woman was properly positioned. The technologists that are doing the examination will be aware of the importance of the proper positioning. It is important to be aware of the motion artifacts. The women are sometimes breathing. Do not talk with the woman during the examination, during the multiphase, during the dynamic scan. Just tell them that you are going to receive the contrast. We are not going to talk to you for the next 5 minutes or 7 minutes. Please breathe very calm. Please do not move. It is very, very important for the quality of the examination and for the interpretation of the examination. This is an example of many motion artifacts which cause misregistration. This is, for example, a subtraction image, and we can see what we call a kind of enhancement of the pectoralis muscle. There is no enhancement of the pectoralis muscle, but because of the misregistration due to movement, we can see pseudo-enhancement, and we can also see enhancement of many areas within the breast. Is it a real finding? We don't know. Misregistration, movement can cause either false negative or false positive findings. That's why it is very, very important. If we are not satisfied with the quality of the examination, we can ask the patient to come back only for the dynamic scan to get a better examination, because the woman thinks, oh, okay, I had breast MRI, which is the best examination. But no, if this is the quality of the examination, this study is not sensitive or is not informative. Another thing that we can see when there is a motion artifact, there is this black area, which is again a clue that there was a motion and that the study is not in good quality and not sensitive enough. So when we are reviewing breast MRI, we are looking at the entire images and focally on lesions, and we are assessing the lesions according to the breast imaging and reporting data system lexicon. Today, the lexicon is on the web, and I think that it's going to be reviewed in the next lecture. So it is available on the web. It is possible to download the card that describing the main features that we have to describe or to look for. And the final assessment, I think that we are all aware of it. Basically, BI-RADS 1 is normal study, 2 is normal study, 3 is low probability of a cancer and short-term follow-up, usually 6 months. BI-RADS 4, we should perform a biopsy. BI-RADS 5, do a biopsy. There is a high, highly suggestive for breast cancer, and BI-RADS 6 for a woman that we know that have breast cancer. Now let's look. We evaluate at the beginning two features. The first one is the fibroglandular density, which is basically analogous to what the breast density on mammography. It is a 4 scale, and the second is the background parenchymal enhancement, and again it is 4 scale. It depends on the menstrual cycle and HRT. There is no correlation between background parenchymal enhancement and fibroglandular tissue density. For example, a woman can have a large amount of fibroglandular tissue, however, she will not have a background parenchymal enhancement. This scenario can be in postmenopausal women not receiving a hormone replacement therapy, because most of the density is most probably fibrotic or not epithelial cells. It is important to know that today we have evidence that increased BP is associated with increased cancer risk, and when we evaluating BP, it is also important to comment whether it is symmetric or asymmetric. So evaluation of the fibroglandular tissue and the in the accordance with the mammography. So this is, for example, almost fatty, scattered fibroglandular tissue, heterogeneously dense and very dense, and it is in correlation with the density on mammography, basically the same. And when we look at the background parenchymal enhancement, again, it divides to 4, minimal, mild, moderate, and marked. And again, very important to comment on the symmetry. Basically, the background parenchymal enhancement should be symmetric, and when it is asymmetric, as was mentioned before, we should know the reason, whether the patient had breast cancer and lumpectomy, or if not, there is a differential diagnosis. So this is an example, as we saw before, asymmetric background parenchymal enhancement, moderate to marked on the left side and minimal on the right side, because the patient had lumpectomy and radiation, which basically kills the living cells in the breast, and that's why there is no enhancement in this side. However, this is an example of a 38-year-old patient, which is high risk, and do we see an asymmetric enhancement, or is it an asymmetric BPE? So there is a differential diagnosis, so we go to the information child that she filled, there is no post-lumpectomy, no radiation, so there is a differential diagnosis, and we go to her previous examination again. She had a mammogram, and it is difficult to see, but there is a small cluster of microcalcifications, and because of the breast, she also had breast ultrasound, and on breast ultrasound she had those two small lesions with microcalcification, and on biopsy it was a DCIS. So in this case, it is not an asymmetric BP, it is an asymmetric enhancement and DCIS. So now let's look at the evaluation of the morphology and the kinetics. Okay, so when we are talking about morphology, we are basically looking on breast MRI on three things. One is the focus, which is a small enhancing lesion, less than 0.5 centimeter, which is usually non-specific and too small to be evaluated. However, if it is a single lesion, we should evaluate it, and I'll show it to you in a minute. And then we are looking at mass lesions and non-mass-like, and assessment and adjunct assessment of the kinetic curves. This is, for example, a 40-year-old BRCA carrier, and she performed an MRI, and this is a T1 post-contrast. Maybe there is something on the left breast. We can see it more clear on the subtracted images, a small focus, it's 0.4 centimeter. And we can see it on the CAD images and on the reformats. So it is a single lesion, 0.4 centimeter, single focus. Maybe we can perform a follow-up. However, we should always consider the background or the clinical history of the patient. Since she is a BRCA, she is high risk. So she has a single focus and she is high risk. That's why this small focus, although it is only 0.4, should be evaluated. Although it is very difficult to evaluate the morphology of the lesion, in this case it should be evaluated. And indeed, she had a second look ultrasound biopsy and it was an invasive ductal carcinoma. And in comparison, we can see this 33-year-old patient, and she has many small foci. And when there are many small foci, we can consider those as part of the BP spectrum, and those can be followed. So when we are evaluating the morphology, so we are looking at mass lesion and non-mass lesion, and I think that this table is too small, but for the mass lesion, we should evaluate the shape of the lesions, and it was changed with the recent BI-RADS addition. We should look at the mass lesion, we should look at the margins, and we should look at the enhancement of the lesions. And for the non-mass, which is basically an enhancement that is not a mass, and we should describe the distribution and the internal enhancement of the lesions. So this is the morphology, and in addition, in MRI, we describe the kinetic assessment, and there are two parts of the kinetic assessment graph, the early phase, which is up to 2 minutes, it's either slow, medium, or fast, and the delayed phase, which is the washout, and for lesions that have washout, they are more suspicious for malignancy. However, morphology wins curvology, or for example, as in this case, this woman has irregular spiculated lesion, which is very, very suspicious morphology. So the curve is persistent, very, very benign. The morphology is very, very suspicious. That's why this lesion is very, very suspicious. And the kinetic is benign, okay. The kinetic is an adjunct. The kinetic will not say, do not perform a biopsy. Okay, very, very important. Always consider the suspicious morphology. Okay, we should also look for additional findings like in mammography and in ultrasound. And in breast MRI, we can sometimes see also non-breast findings, either in the mediastinum abdomen or the bones. This is, for example, a pericardial cyst on a T2 weighted scan. This is, for example, a liver cyst. And in this case, there is a lesion in the sternum, which we follow it and there is no change. Okay, so we also should be aware of those. However, it is very important, sometimes those lesions are at the end of our scan. So if we are not sure, we should comment on them and recommend maybe further assessment, but we should try not to imagine findings that we are not sure that they are there, okay? Another additional findings that we can see on breast MRI is, for example, the pre-contrast ducts, which sometimes are dilated and high signal. And here is an example of T1 pre-contrast, and we can see bilaterally high signal ducts. This is a pre-contrast scan, so meaning it might be a proteinaceous content. And this is after contrast administration, and there is basically no change, or no, it is not more prominent. And on, again, the same. And on the subtraction images, there is no enhancement. It is very, very important for those cases to see that there is no misregistration, because misregistration might cause a false positive enhancement of the duct. So in this case, it's very, very important to see that there was a high signal in the ducts before the contrast administration and it is benign. Implants, it was Dr. Razi spoke about it. Basically, the implant protocol is without contrast. However, for example, in our hospital, whenever there is an implant, we perform also injection. It takes another 7 or 10 minutes since the availability of the MRI is problematic. We always do both the implant protocol and the contrast administration. So normal implant, intracapsular, extracapsular, intracapsular rupture. And this patient had intact breast implants. However, she had multifocal breast carcinoma. And again, I'd like to mention those small foci, multiple, many foci. So those are foci, non-specific. She is young and we follow up those. Final report again, importance of the clinical history, importance to review prior films, important to have a proper MRI technique and then to describe the findings and the final BI-RADS assessment recommendation. For BI-RADS zero, meaning that we see a lesion on the breast MRI and we want another study like breast ultrasound, we always should recommend, okay, if we will find this lesion on breast ultrasound, do a biopsy, but if not, please either do a 6 months follow-up or do an MRI-guided biopsy. We should conclude the entire study and not leave it for the doctor that is going to do the ultrasound, maybe not us, and he will say, I don't see anything, and then we'll send the patient. So we should conclude our evaluation and recommendation. We should be aware of surgical clips. I'll show it next. This was also a comment by the BI-RADS committee. A patient with a known breast cancer and she's doing breast MRI for the extent of disease, so basically she is a BI-RADS 6. No, we should conclude it or as a BI-RADS 4 since we would like the evaluation of additional lesions to be biopsied, so it is a BI-RADS 4 study. From my personal experience, we have, as I said, on breast MRI around between 2,000 to 3,000 images. So it is very important when we evaluate and conclude the study to comment on the site, on the location, on the quadrant, and in addition, on the position of the lesion where it was exactly, since sometimes there are few lesions or the lesions are small, and I think that the most accurate way is to comment or to mention the position of the bed as is seen, that if the woman goes to another facility, that it will be possible to review and to find exactly where was the lesion. So in summary, breast MRI is very important and it is part of our imaging modalities in breast cancer imaging and diagnosis. We as radiologists are responsible for the quality of the examination to teach our technicians how to perform. We should be familiar with the indication, with the clinical history. We should be aware when to perform the study and to tell our secretaries and technicians to be aware of the importance of the time of the examination. We should be aware of the proper technique, how to read, and the final assessment and recommendation. I would just like to review a few cases. So, 36-year-old woman, high risk. What do we see? Okay, so it is a non-mass enhancement, okay? Non-mass enhancement, so what is the BI-RADS? I see residence. BI-RADS? Two is normal. Okay, she's high risk and there is a non-mass enhancement. Four, okay, so she needs a biopsy, okay? So she comes to the biopsy, breast MRI biopsy. We perform it only if the patient already had a previous scan. So she comes for the breast MRI. Now the secretary makes the appointment according to her menstrual cycle. And now what do we see? So we see findings, basically. There is a small foci. And what is the BI-RADS now? So whenever we cancel a biopsy, we say it is a BI-RADS tumor, most probably benign, and she's going to have a 6 months follow-up. The importance of scheduling the examination according to the menstrual cycle, okay? What is wrong here? Residents, I see our residents. Yes, residents. What is wrong? Move, and do you see contrast? Okay, and I'll show you, there is no contrast. And there is pseudo-enhancement. Sometimes it is very confusing. I receive the examination and say, is there, I don't see contrast, very, very important. So if you're not sure that you see the contrast or the techniques that are, the technologists that are performing the examination, call your physician, ask them to see, to review the image. Oh, no, okay. So go to the patient, ask her if there was a problem, and if not, okay, there is a problem in the scan and we are going to repeat the study. Very, very important not to review this image as enhancement, okay? Very, very important. Be sure that you see the contrast. What is the diagnosis? Well, since I know only you, residents. Okay, so it is normal BPE, moderate bilateral symmetric, okay? Do not call it enhancement or non-mass enhancement. Okay, this is a 66-year-old woman. She complained of left breast nipple itching. Her mammography and ultrasound were normal. And to evaluate the complaint, the clinical complaint, her surgeon sent her to an MRI. And this MRI, what do you see? So, okay, so maybe there is enhancement of the left nipple. Okay. So it was read as enhancement of the left nipple and rule out Paget. Okay, and the surgeon evaluated or examined the patient again and didn't see anything, and she came to us. And I also examined the patient, didn't see anything. There is no nipple retraction, no change in the nipple. So we thought maybe the problem was with the positioning of the patient. So we repeated the scan. We raised the breast. And the breast was in the middle, perpendicular, straight, and we see that there is no enhancement in the nipple. Very, very important. Be aware of proper positioning, otherwise you make the patient sick. Okay, important, important. So she doesn't have Paget, and okay, so the final BI-RADS was one. Very, very important. 74-year-old woman, she came, left breast palpable mass, mammography, breast density. Today it was changed to ABCD, so it's D, very dense. What are the findings? So, no findings, okay? But since she has a palpable lesion, so what is next? We did ultrasound, and in ultrasound there was a small lesion at the area of the palpable area, so it is round, okay, but since it is palpable in an old lady, we thought it's a BI-RADS 4, and we did a biopsy, and it was an invasive ductal carcinoma. What's next? That's the MRI for the evaluation of extent of disease, and on MRI, okay, we see a mass, okay, and we also see a non-mass enhancement anterior to the lesion, okay, and here it is So this mass is the same as the mass that was seen on ultrasound, and we see a suspicious kinetic assessment. A minute, I'll just do this, okay. And for the non-mass, we see different kinetic assessment. So I'm always asked, okay, do you do the kinetic curves assessment always? I prefer the CAD color images since they show the same information. Since for the curves, we put an ROI, and it is only for a certain area. When we use those color maps, we see the entire picture, and we can also see that the heterogeneity of the breast cancer, and we know that breast cancer is heterogeneous. We saw it with the diffusion, and we see it also with the color maps. So I think that the color maps are enough, but if you prefer to do the curves, it is also possible. But I think that the color maps gives you the entire picture. Okay, so from a 9 millimeter mass that she had an ultrasound, it is a 9 centimeter, and the patient had mastectomy. What is this? This is a T1 facet. This is a T2. Fat necrosis. So this is why it is very important to have a non-fat. Here we can see enhancement, and this is an area of a fat because it was suppressed on a T1 fat suppression, and on a T2 non-fat set we see it is in high signal, so it is a fat necrosis lesion, benign, PI-RADS2, okay. This is an example of T1 before T2 and the subtraction, and the diagnosis is cyst. Okay, but please look at the skin thickening. Please look at the edema. So, is there another option? Abscess. Another option? The patient had surgery. So, it's a post-op and post-radiation. That's why the clinical information is very, very, very important. Okay. I'm almost done. Nipple discharge, this patient complained of nipple discharge. So this is a T1 pre-contrast, and again we see an example of high signal intensity in the ducts and dilated duct. She had a vacuum-assisted biopsy, so this is an hematoma seroma. This is a post-contrast scan, and it's very difficult to say where is the enhancement. However, on the subtraction images, we can see the non-mass enhancement, and we can see the mass. Okay, so very important in patients with nipple discharge, high signal intensity in the duct, to evaluate all the images and to be aware of misregistration artifact. Just, and I think I spoke about it last year, we have 2,000, 3,000 images, long protocol. It is possible, Professor Kuhl described, and there are many publication since then about an abbreviated breast MRI, basically to perform only the dynamic scan before and after. They performed in for 3 minutes, but I think it is reasonable to perform only the dynamic scan before and 3 to 4 times repetition. It will take from 7 to 10 minutes, and to evaluate only the enhancement. And if there is enhancement, describe the morphology, describe the enhancement, and conclude the BI-RADS and complete the evaluation with second look ultrasound or MRI. And just to, I would like to mention that I think it's next week or in 2 weeks, Professor Kuhl is coming for a meeting that is going to be here in Caesarea. I think I'll ask you to come. I think it's very important and interesting and teaching, educating. Thank you.